Got these horses out here this morning. And pulled some weeds and did some trimming. So instead of making a burn pile, I put those leaves and trimming around the bottom of the tree there, you can see. And now they're going to fight over it. Buddy's going to take from Mr. T. Mr. T must have found a good one. So I have these trimmings. I put them around a tree so they'll like compost out and feed the tree and just circle around it. They'll decompose around the tree a little bit. Keep moisture there. When I water it, it'll help it from not evaporating. So I thought it was a pretty good idea. Obviously, horses don't agree. I let them out. Come say hello. And Mr. T goes over there and starts pawing and digging through it. Now they're pulling out these old weeds pulled a week ago, half decomposed. Hi, kitty. This kitty's following around. And now they're going to eat them. I don't get it. You would think, I got these roses over there coming out, and normally Buddy eats all the roses, but those aren't regular roses. I don't know what they are. Some flower person can tell me. But for some reason, if they were red roses or yellow, Buddy'd be all over them. So would Mr. T. They love their yellow and red roses. But they don't seem to bother them. But anyway, I just found it interesting that they let these guys out here roaming around, kind of watching them. Buddy better not mess with that fruit tree. I'll beat him like a stepchild. I gotta stay focused because I want the timing correct. If he puts his mouth on that tree, I want him to hear my correction immediately. He's smelling, he's getting close, he's teasing me. Okay, didn't, good. What I've done is I've got these, hi Mr. T. We're filming a stupid YouTube-y horsey humans, educating them, think like a horse. It's like, whatever, you can't train stupid humans, they're just stupid. Good boy, Mr. T. Oh, somebody made a comment somewhere on YouTube that says, I've got a Mustang next door, and he told me all humans are stupid and incompetent. I got to reply to her and tell her, that's a smart horse. So anyway, I'm not sure why Mr. T wants to eat. Maybe he's eating the grass now, but I've got to go redo my little compost pile around there. If you know... Hi, kitty. What are you doing? I'm trying to film. You're being just like a nosy horse. Look. Look at little kitty's butt. What are you doing? Mr. T, the cat's messed up the program. Come over here and stomp it. Stupid cat. So if you notice these gates up here at the front, what I've done is I've let these horses go. I'll walk up here and kind of show you. I put some panels up here. Because the horses are getting a little fat in this pasture. Green grass is too long. Mr. T. See, he's as wide as he is tall. He's like, whatever, dude. You got room to talk. So he's getting a little crusty, a little fat. So I'm trying to pull them off that pasture a little bit for a few hours a day. But I don't like locking them up in a stall. So what I did is I put some panels up here. And I've just kind of cordoned off the driveway. So these guys get to walk on the rocks, they're filing down their feet, they're toughening up their feet. It's getting dry here, so their feet are getting nice and hard. So walk across this rocky driveway, which I don't normally like, but in winter when it's moist, they're kind of tender-footed. But as it's drying out, getting more summery up here, their feet are getting nice and hard. So walking on these rocks is probably good for them. Do some minor chipping, minor sculpting of the wall and the sole. So you see these panels, I put a water gate there, and I put panels at the other end. So now they have this cordon on both sides. Now what I don't like about this is there's barbed wire and there's not a lot of grass to lay down. So I put them out here during the day, the heat of the day, and let them roam through there. And that way they can kind of, they got trees down there for shade. I put some water. They've got this small area so they can't eat a whole bunch. And that'll just pull them off that thick green pasture. it's kind of a founder protection kind of thing. I don't know if they're going to founder. Most people seem to think that they won't because they've been here for a few months. They've been eating a pasture. They were eating it before. So it's not like you shock the system. It's not like I keep them locked up and then stick them out there and just let them feast and get all fat real quick. Shocking the system is the key to horses. Internals. They've got a lot of intestine, 75 feet, 100 feet of large and small intestine in there. And when you feed them something, as it works through there, their little chemical reaction makes, you know, certain bacteria that fights the new food. So when you shock a horse's system or you change their diet immediately, their system can't keep up with changing large amounts of the right, you know, bacteria in the gut. So that's why you always want to do it gradually. That's why they say don't change your horse's food fast. If you change it gradually, though, it's usually okay. So they've got all this green grass. Everybody says, oh, they're not going to founder because I don't like my horse getting this fat. Mr. T's really crusty, and Mustangs tend to do that because they're what's easy keepers. So if you give them a little bit of food, they usually do pretty good. You don't have to feed them a lot. Thoroughbreds, on the other hand, they're usually thin. Tend to be on the thin side, so you tend to feed them more. Sometimes you get them overweight because they got those long, skinny legs, and that's not good for them either. But both of my guys are, like I said, Mr. T is like a four-legged tick. He's so damn fat right now. Buddy's getting up there, but he's not quite as bad as Mr. T. So they go in there for a few hours a day. I lock them up, usually during the heat of the day. They can go down there and just stand in the shade and relax. I don't like barbed wire on both sides. It gives a small area, so if they lay down. But they normally don't lay down in the heat of the day like that in the sun. So I've just been putting them in there for a few days and trying to let this fresh spring grass kind of die down a little bit because it's just too damn green out here. So anyway, we'll end that there. I forgot even why I started this thing. I guess I'll call this preventing founder or founder awareness maybe. So you don't let your horses get too fat. Another thing that they shock the system on horses is when you get these rescues and you get these really thin horses, UC Davis, if you go to their website, their veterinary school, they found that the best thing for really malnutrition horses is just feed them straight alfalfa for a while. Now, if you get a severe malnutrition horse and just throw them 10 flakes of alfalfa and let them, I'm sorry, Mr. T, I used my hand. I was talking. He's like, dude, are you talking to me? I don't know if you saw that reaction. He kind of stopped. He flinched. He looked his head because he saw my hand move. And he was like, he thought I told him to move. So anyway, don't shock the system. Even on a malnutrition horse, start them off slowly. I've seen so many horses get killed and die because people love them to death. They get them. They feel sorry for them. They're thin. Let me fatten them up, you know. And next thing you know, they're giving them grain, corn, throwing corn oil on there for extra. They try to get all that weight that took months, if a year, to get them that skinny, and they try to put it on in a week. And that shocks the system, and that kills a lot of horses. Slow way is the fast way. Just about everything with horses, whether it's feed, whether you're trimming the feet, whether it's training, whether exposing something, whether it's the slow way is the fast way. Just take your time with horses. They learn better. It makes it easier on you. Makes it easier on a horse. And that there, hope that helps. Mr. T, you're a good boy. Yes, you are, buddy. Quit eating all that grass, you big fatty.